Hello, wrestling fans. I'm Boyd Pierce, your host this week on another edition of Mid-South Wrestling. I hope you'll join us for the full 60 minutes. A lot of exciting action. You'll see the one-man gang returning to the Mid-South area. Also, tag team action. The Mid-South tag team title holders, Hacksaw Jim Duggan and Magnum T.A. in the ring against the rugged duo of King Kong Bundy and the Missing Link. The Junkyard Dog takes on the Outdoorsman from the Minnesota Northwoods, Crusher Darso. Hacksaw Butch Reed is here. You'll see all the action, and to tell you about it, one of the great commentators of all time, former wrestling referee, and now actively involved in the promotion of Mid-South Wrestling in Tulsa, Oklahoma, Jim Ross. Jim?
Boy, it's always great to be here, and of course, matchmaker Grizzly Smith has got another tremendous card. It's a great card with a great lineup of stars, and I think without further ado, Boyd, why don't we go to the ring with Reese Bowden and the introductions now.
We're ready. Let's go.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 313 pounds, from Moscow, Russia, Nikolai Volkov. And in the blue corner at 238 pounds, from Hendersonville, Tennessee, Johnny Rich.
As the introduction of the opening event, Pee Wee Anderson is the referee, and he calls for the bell between two top stars in professional wrestling, Johnny Rich versus Nikolai Volkov. Jim?
Oh boy, this is a classic confrontation of speed and quickness, and Johnny Rich against a man that is just a tremendous, a superhuman individual, and I'm referring to 313 pounds of Nikolai Volkov. Moscow, Russia, he's very, very proud of his Russian heritage, and he is an unbelievable physical specimen. One of the strongest men in all of wrestling. One of the strongest men in all of wrestling, and one of the strongest men in the world, Nikolai Volkov. 600 pound bench press, 600 pound one hand deadlift, 600 pounds. And Johnny Rich has been in the ring with some very, very tough individuals and has always fared very well. But he's here against a man that I'm terming as superhuman, because he's going through Johnny Rich like I don't know what, and he's just on a relentless individual, about 6'5", 313 pounds, and Johnny Rich has been in there with the best of them. He's been in there with the top competition from coast to coast, but I've never seen Johnny Rich receive the punishment as he's receiving now against this man, Nikolai Volkov.
Well, Jim, it's like we said, all the top stars, these are truly, truly top stars, Johnny Rich and Nikolai Volkov, are coming to the Mid-South area because that's where the action is, because of the greatest fans in the world, the greatest television viewers, and Grizzly Smith brings them right here on Mid-South Wrestling.
The man stands 6'5", 313 pounds. He's in tremendous physical condition, unbelievably strong. Johnny Rich came off with a thundering right hand that didn't even phase the big Russian. A man I tried to communicate with earlier in the match, I tried to get some information from me. Look at the strength. One hand holding Johnny Rich over 230 pounds. Just lift him up off the ground like a rag doll. The man is very arrogant. He's very proud of his Russian heritage. And, of course, the wrestling fans and the whole world knows the situation with the Russian people now. And this man is very, very proud of that Russian heritage. He's the heavyweight champion of Russia. He has a man above his head now, Johnny Rich. A tremendous backbreaker, and I've never seen anyone get up in the backbreaker from the Russian. And Nikolai Volkov, in short order, takes care of Johnny Rich.
And we have more exciting action coming up after we return on Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
Wrestling fans, on September the 9th in Houston, Texas at the Sam Houston Coliseum was a great night of Mid-South Wrestling action, but one of the highlights on that card was scheduled to be a match between the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, and from Atlanta, Larry Zbysko. Larry Zbysko has scouted all the great talent in the Mid-South area, and for some reason, he failed to appear on that night on September the 9th in Houston. Dusty Rhodes received a victory for that match, a forfeited victory, but on the scene came King Kong Bundy. And as you wrestling fans know, King Kong Bundy and Dusty Rhodes have long had a feud, and King Kong Bundy said, "You're not going to get out of here that easily, and I challenge you to a match." Well, knowing the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, as we all do, he accepted that challenge. But little was he to know that Dusty Rhodes had a plan set upon him by the Big Mountain King Kong Bundy, as he had the one-man gang standing in the wings. It was an exciting match. It was narrated by Paul Bosch, and let's go to Houston, Texas now for the edited highlights of that match.
His opponent, Larry Zbysko, has failed to appear, and now as the Bundy comes in and issues a challenge to the dust. Dusty Rhodes, and Dusty is suddenly taking on a man twice the weight of the man whom he expected to be up against. And as he bounces around that ring, he is the all-American dream from one end to the other. And King Kong Bundy has suddenly found himself on the... Whoa, there's the wind-up in the pitch. Listen to the uproar from this huge crowd here at the Sam Houston Coliseum tonight. King Kong has won by beating Chief Lightfoot, Joe Lightfoot. And now Dusty has come down on that head, and he, listen to the uproar, tremendous uproar. And here comes a one-man gang. Two huge individuals in that ring right now. As well, there's a bell, and we're going to have a disqualification. But Dusty is caught in the middle as the one-man gang lays into the All-American Dream, and the Bundy defensive. Here comes somebody running down the aisle. I don't know who it is. It is Magnum T.A. And he ran right smack into a blow that knocked him down. We've got things popping on the ring right now here as they go to work on him. And here is Dusty up on his feet. Rip Snorton. Here is Hacksaw Duggan. And Duggan roars into the ring. And Duggan flails away. And Duggan picks on the one-man gang. A wild, wild scene here as Duggan clears the ring, and Dusty and the one-man gang fight out in the fenced-in area here, and they hold Dusty back. They hang on to him to keep him from chasing Bundy, chasing the one-man gang up the aisle. But the gang has disappeared, and Bundy is still at ringside here, wondering what he's going to do to save his skin and his reputation. Dusty Rhodes up in the ring, begging them to come. And there he is, rewarding the people who have helped him.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, at 387 and a half pounds, managed by General Skandor Akbar from Chicago, Illinois, the one-man gang. And in the blue corner at 230 pounds from Fort Worth, Texas, Ron Ellis.
Ron Ellis in the Aqua Tights against the big man who signifies by his name title as just what he is, a one-man gang. Now you see the man presenting him, General Skandor Akbar, as Johnny Martinez raises his hand, puts it down, calls for the bell, and action underway.
Oh boy, this ought to be another confrontation of speed and quickness against a tremendous man of size and strength. The one-man gang standing on 6 feet nine, 387 pounds against Ron Ellis at 230. And I'll say right now at the outset that Ron Ellis has got a tall, tall order lined up for him by matchmaker Grizzly Smith as the much improved one-man gang, as General Skandor Akbar has been bragging and boasting in the dressing room. I was trying to talk to Akbar earlier tonight. He is telling me that I would not recognize the one-man gang, that he has improved tremendously, that the one-man gang is here on a mission and he's here to settle some scores, and what scores that pertains to remains to be seen. But the one-man gang at 387 pounds, when he was here before, Boyd, I'm sure you remember, you were here, that he inflicted some tremendous damage on some great wrestling stars here in this area.
He certainly did, Jim.
One-man gang hails from Chicago, Illinois. Hammering away those big club-like right hands on Ron Ellis. One-man gang, and the gang has got him up, setting for that country slam as General Skandor Akbar. I thought he was going to set him for the country slam. The one-man gang, very methodical. And they're the one-man gang with a country slam. And that should be all. And right there, the big splash, and I can guarantee you that'll be all. Ron Ellis going down to defeat. Very impressively, and I think General Skandor Akbar is right. I have to agree with him for once. The much improved one-man gang of Victor.
And we'll be back when action continues after this message.
Before we go to another great match here on Mid-South Wrestling, and that'll be Hacksaw Jim Duggan and Magnum T.A. against King Kong Bundy and the Missing Link in tag team action, we have some edited highlights from last week right here on Mid-South Wrestling, a very, very controversial involvement between the Junkyard Dog and King Kong Bundy. You fans that were here with us last week, remember that confrontation? Well, General Skandar Akbar and King Kong Bundy obviously had a plan, and that plan involved the Missing Link. Their objective, very simply, was to erase the Junkyard Dog from the scene, which would help Ted DiBiase against his battle with Hacksaw Jim Duggan later on in that card. Well, the match between the Junkyard Dog and King Kong Bundy was quite a confrontation indeed. It did bring in the Missing Link. It was a great, great match. And let's look at the edited highlights of that match now.
Bundy's got JYD. This could be the biggest upset in wrestling. One, two, three, but it's got to be a five count, Boyd. Four. That dog, whoa. Look at that. Look at that. The dog, 600-pound bench press power. He pressed Bundy clear off on top. And Rick Ferrara was actually smashed like being run over with an asphalt steamroller. And Bundy back up and taking it to the dog, with the dog fighting back with that heart that made him so great. That's the courage factor. Oh, and he just decapitated Bundy. New referees coming into the ring to make the count. Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer just came in the ring. Referee calling for the disqualification. But Sawyer's out there, the dog's got Sawyer. Mad Dog Sawyer is out there, the dog is whipping him. Now Bundy catches the dog from behind. Sawyer's holding, looks like Bundy's gonna take dog's head off. Dog got out of the way, Bundy almost decapitated Buzz Sawyer. Now the dog is firing back. Dog picked him up for the thump. I never could believe it, dog picked him up for the thump. Dog has got him for the thump. The missing link just dove off on the dog. The missing link just dove off on the log. Now that's Mad Dog, they're all on him. They're all on the dog. The missing link just driving it in. The missing link is pounding the dog. Buzz Sawyer, Bundy. The Junkyard Dog has had to take on the whole card, it looks like. Here comes Hacksaw Jim. Here comes the dog. The friends of Dugan just tore the head off of Buzz Sawyer. He's after the missing link. Magnum T.A., George Weingrove, and Dugan. Dugan is really upset.
This is a non-title tag team event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 420 pounds from Atlantic City, New Jersey, King Kong Bundy. And his partner at 251 pounds from parts unknown, Max, the Missing Link. And in the blue corner, the Mid-South Tag Team Champions at 282 pounds from New York City, Hacksaw Jim Duggan. And his partner at 238 pounds from Virginia Beach, Virginia, Magnum T.A.
The ring completely filled with people that reached about, and as referee Rick Ferrara, General Skandar Akbar and his men, King Kong Bundy and the Missing Link, and on the opposite side, the Mid-South Tag Team Champions Hacksaw Jim Duggan on the outside, and in the ring representing their team is Magnum T.A. from Virginia Beach, Virginia.
Well, boy, we've said many times here, matchmaker Grizzly Smith continually outdoes himself, and this match here could definitely be a main event in any wrestling arena from coast to coast or around the world. And you've got the very controversial, the mystery man that General Skandar Akbar has brought into this area, the missing link. They call him Max. Akbar doesn't want to be called Mad Max, and he seems impervious to pain when taking punishment around the head. He's in there against a very popular 238-pounder from Virginia Beach, Virginia, Magnum T.A., and T.A. moves out of the way very quickly, and a miscalculation there between the missing link and King Kong Bundy. We have a very interesting contrast in styles here once again, as you see General Skandar Akbar directing traffic there. Magnum T.A. and Hacksaw Jim Duggan, the Mid-South Tag Team Champions, they wrestle together in many of the arenas around the region. However, and their opponents, not tag team partners regularly, so I would say that on the outset that Duggan and T.A. would have the advantage as far as the teamwork was concerned. But as far as the unorthodox tactics, that's got to go to General Skandar Akbar's duo of King Kong Bundy, the man from Atlantic City.
Jim, this is a non-title match, but action couldn't be more fast-paced than it is right now, even if it was a title contest.
Well, I think the fans all realize, and I'm sure that General Skandar Akbar has his men primed, that if they can defeat these Mid-South Tag Team Champions right here on television in this non-title bout, that Grizzly Smith will give them a title match. And that's what they're there for. The titles mean money, and that's what these men are in the ring for, is to make money. Good combination tag out by Max, tagging in 420-pound King Kong Bundy. Bundy with a backbreaker against Magnum T.A., and T.A. is in deep, deep trouble now. Bundy choking away. Bundy choking. It's really frustrating to see a man that size resort to tactics like choking when he's so large, has the weight and strength advantage. And why can't he utilize those assets instead of resorting to the choking tactics that he so often does? Smooth tag in and out. That's a power slam by Max. The missing link, a man in tremendous condition. The missing link, and Magnum T.A. fighting back. Magnum T.A. has got some of that big heart of Hacksaw Jim Duggan has rubbed off on this young man. But again, the missing link right back on top with the advantage. And perhaps I spoke too soon. Perhaps I spoke too soon about the teamwork of Duggan and T.A. And right now, the team of King Kong Bundy and the missing link utilizing some excellent teamwork here in this tag team confrontation. Bundy with those tree-like arms wrapped around the jaw and that reverse chin lock that he has firmly entrenched there on Magnum T.A.
If he drops it in lower, it becomes a chokehold, but Rick Pereira, the referee, checked, and so it's illegal at this moment.
Well, I tell you, Boyd, I've been in a squared circle with that striped shirt on many, many times, and I don't envy whatsoever. I'm much happier sitting where I am now than in there where Rick Pereira is. He's got four men he's got to keep an eye on.
Five, if you count General Skandar Akbar, who's on the outside of the ring.
That's a very good point. That's exactly right, and you have to do that as an official. Magnum T.A. trying to get over and tag Hacksaw Duggan, who has not been in this bout yet. Magnum T.A. has taken a tremendous amount of punishment from both men, from both Bundy and Mad Max, who General Skandar Akbar cringes when he hears people call him Mad Max. He likes to be referred to simply as Max. Bundy going for the elbow, and Magnum T.A. very luckily and very alertly rolls out of the way.
And he made the tag.
He makes the tag. And in comes Hacksaw Jim Duggan, a man that backs up from no one. Duggan with those right hands and those kicks. And I guarantee you, he's as tough as they come, Boyd.
But it didn't matter in that instance whether he was inside the ring or on the outside, because he ganged up on both of Bundy and Max on the outside. And makes the tag, and in comes Magnum T.A.
Well, the momentum has swung back to the side of Magnum T.A. and Hacksaw Duggan. Magnum T.A. and Hacksaw Duggan, and all four men are in the ring. Magnum T.A., the legal man on his team. Drop kick, and out goes Max. Big, big backdrop, and Bundy goes down. Bundy goes down, and there's a spear. There is the spear. Max is on the top rope. Max is on the top rope. That's an automatic disqualification. The referee calling for the bell. An automatic disqualification. And the winners of the match by disqualification. Hacksaw Jim Duggan and King Kong Bundy going for another big splash. Magnum T.A. laying prone on the mat. Hacksaw Duggan fighting both men. Hacksaw Duggan fighting both men. The winners of the match are the Mid-South Tag Team Champions by disqualification. And another spear by Duggan. Out goes Bundy and out goes Mad Max. Hacksaw Duggan cleaning up the ring. The winners of the match are the tag team champions by disqualification. And we'll have to see just how badly, Magnum T.A. is. But boy, another great match.
Tremendous, and we'll be back with more exciting action following this important message.
Wrestling fans, coming up next here on Mid-South Wrestling, the Junkyard Dog will take on the unbelievable challenge of the undefeated 303-pound Crusher Darceau. But before we go to the ring for that match, we want to show you some more edited highlights of a match that happened here last week. Earlier today, we did show you the edited highlights of the Junkyard Dog against King Kong Bundy. There was a story behind that. They wanted to get the Junkyard Dog out of the picture so that when Ted DiBiase went against Hacksaw Duggan in a match that DiBiase said if he did not win, he would leave the Mid-South area. Well, they felt like that if the Junkyard Dog was out of the picture, that DiBiase would have a much, much easier time in a no-disqualification match against Hacksaw Duggan and beating Duggan and DiBiase staying in the area. Well, things didn't quite work out that way. They had a plan. They discounted the fact of the two biggest hearts in all of professional wrestling, and I'm talking about the hearts of the Junkyard Dog and Hacksaw Duggan, two men with unbelievable resiliency, two men that are bound together with a common bond that is unbelievable and very heartwarming. Well, let's go to that match now, the match between Ted DiBiase and Hacksaw Duggan. And remember, DiBiase said if he didn't win the match that he would leave the area. Here are those highlights now, narrated by Cowboy Bill Watts.
Never heard of Jim Bill. He reversed it. He's got DiBiase's figure four reversed. He reversed DiBiase's figure four. DiBiase's in pain now. The referee asking DiBiase. There's the Road Warriors. There's the Road Warriors, Boyd. The Road Warriors are pounding. They're pounding Duggan. The Road Warriors are pounding Duggan. Looks like DiBiase had himself a safety valve, a backup. Now look at him, they're holding him. They're holding Duggan. Duggan's fought to his feet. Now they're holding for DiBiase. Look at DiBiase. He's got the both of them holding. He's slapping Duggan. The worst insult, he's slapping Duggan. He's slapping him. Ted DiBiase's taunting him and slapping him. Jim Duggan's helpless with the two powerful. Here goes Magna T.A. and Rick Rude, that the Road Warriors catch him coming. Now DiBiase picks Jim Duggan up to put the coup de grace on him. DiBiase picks him up to put the coup de grace on him. DiBiase loads up. Got the Junkyard Dog.
There's a dog.
There's the Junkyard Dog. Oh, gosh, he just, whoo, he splattered DiBiase. The Road Warrior got him.
The back, front, everything that's available, the dog is putting it on him, Bill.
But there's, the Road Warrior's got dog from behind. Now DiBiase's got the board. DiBiase's got that board, and it looks like he's going to put JYD out. Looks like DiBiase's going to really tee off on
Duggan made it!
Duggan speared him, boy. Now Duggan's got the board.
Now Tide has turned.
Oh, boy. Boy, look at that. Duggan is putting it to him. King Rat's getting it. Look at JYD's pitching. And Duggan's going to be hitting home runs. Boy, I can't believe the action here.
The dog threw him in, and Duggan laid it on him. A home run for Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
And now Ted DiBiase's got it. No disqualification, Boyd. No, no disqualification. No disqualification. Well, there it is. One, two. Great brother. Duggan won. Duggan the winner.
Duggan threw the board down and jumped right on him.
Dog. Look at the heart dog. It's hurt. You can still see how hurt dog is. But his heart came. He couldn't let Duggan go down to that kind of beating. Ted DiBiase, by his own words, will have to pack his bag and leave Mid-South.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 303 pounds, from the north woods of northern Minnesota, Crusher Darso. And at 296 pounds from Tennessee, the Junkyard Dog.
Crusher Darso, 303 pounds, the outdoorsman from the Minnesota Northwoods against the inimitable Junkyard Dog. Pee Wee Anderson is the third man in the ring. Jim?
Well, a tremendous confrontation here of two big, strong athletes. And one thing about Crusher Darso, He's a very, seems to be a very laid-back individual, but he's also an undefeated individual, a man that's trying to build a reputation. He saw a Mid-South Wrestling television program in Minnesota on the cable systems. He said he wanted to come here for the toughest competition in the world, which is right here. And he's going to get to go against the toughest competitor in the world, and that's a Junkyard Dog. A tremendous test of strength there. Both men attempting to apply the overhand wrist lock. Crusher Darceau, a man of tremendous strength. But don't forget that 600-pound bench press that the Junkyard Dog has had a tremendous strength. And the Junkyard Dog bulked up at 298. Crusher Darceau at 303 pounds. And Darceau thought about it. He thought about it, but the dog was ready.
A perfect block there. He was waiting for him, Jim. That Junkyard Dog, that I tell you, just an outstanding athlete.
Well, the Junkyard Dog has got a lot of tremendous attributes, but looking at this match in particular, the one thing that the dog has is experience. He's got the experience over this man, but Darceau has got the youth, the enthusiasm, and the tremendous strength as he's exhibited right now. As he has got the dog in a tremendous bear hug, a man that trained and became a recluse in the backwoods of Minnesota, a man that hunted his food, hunted and fished, a man that stayed away from the public for months at a time, getting himself ready, mentally and physically ready, for a career in professional wrestling. The dog comes out of it with a hip toss, the dog with that hip lock, and the big man from Minnesota goes down, comes right back up though. This is the biggest match, undoubtedly, in the career of Crusher Darceau. He wants to go against the toughest, and the man goes right under the dog and gets right back to the bear hug. The Junkyard Dog taking on the toughest competition wherever he is, whatever coast he's on, whatever city he's in, that's got to take a toll on him. And he's in a man that's real hungry, a man that right here on national television wants to make a name for himself by beating the number one box office attraction in all of wrestling, and that's the Junkyard Dog. The dog trying to come underneath those arms and utilize that strength that he has, and he's got it. The dog has reversed the bear hug, and now Darceau is gonna feel exactly how strong the dog is. Don't forget, wrestling fans, we've got more to come. It's a great, great hour. The North American champion, Hacksaw Reed, will be here later, and a newcomer, Jim the Hamble Neidhart, will be here. Back at the match at hand, the Junkyard Dog, Crusher Darceau, the dog with that hip toss again after blocking the maneuver by Darceau. Darceau kicking out very quickly, the dog back up to his feet. And Darceau's feeling the strength of the dog in those ribs. The dog likewise, both men circling each other very slowly, both men very carefully stalking each other. And I'll have to say that the young man from Minnesota's made, Darceau comes out with that football maneuver, that tackle, Darceau with that tackle. And the dog went down. The dog went down from the 303-pound pressure of Crusher Darceau. Now Darceau is going for that reverse backbreaker. Darceau has got the dog, and if he locks it in, that's all for the Junkyard Dog. The dog's going for the ropes. Here's the experience, the Junkyard Dog. Down goes Darceau. The experience of the Junkyard Dog and that great strength. The Junkyard Dog with that forearm. And that howl will send chills up your spine. The dog has got him up with that big thump. And there's the thump, 298 pounds of the Junkyard Dog. And Crusher Darceau has just had his first defeat on wrestling. Crusher Darceau has just been defeated for the first time.
And the hand raised out of the Junkyard Dog by referee Pee Wee Anderson, a tremendous victory. And we have a lot of action continuing after this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
This is a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 260 pounds, from Kansas City, Missouri, the North American heavyweight champion, Hacksaw Butch Reed. And in the blue corner at 238 pounds, from Indianapolis, Indiana, George Weingroff.
Hacksaw Butch Reed, the North American heavyweight champion, against a courageous athlete from the University of Tennessee at Chattanooga. Although legally blind, a lot of courage, a lot of finesse, and a great wrestling ability, George Weingroff.
Well, George Weingroff certainly cannot be taken lightly by the North American champion, Hacksaw Butch Reed. Reed, a tremendous athlete, just a tremendous athlete. As we've said here many times, you don't have to agree with his philosophy on life and his outlook on things, but you can't take away the fact, good fireman's carry takedown. Good fireman's carry maneuver Fireman's carry takedown by George Weingroff. You can't take away from the athletic ability of the North American champion. A solid, solid 260-pounder. Duck under, go behind, back into the hammerlock is George Weingroff. Reed reverses it. You know the ironic thing about it? Drop toe hold, and Weingroff floats on top of him. The ironic thing about Hacksaw Butch Reed is the fact that he likes to battle, he likes to kick, he likes to punch, and he can go just as rough and just as long as anybody. But he has great wrestling ability. And he also has tremendous strength, as evidence right there, as he picked up double-legged George Weingroff, picked him up and took him to that corner, to those turnbuckles. George Weingroff, as Boyd mentioned earlier, a man that has a tremendous amount of heart and courage, an individual that's legally blind, always has time to talk to the fans, a tremendous young man, and a credit to the professional wrestling fraternity. But he has got his hands full there against the North American champion, a man that says he's going to reign as a champion for as long as he wants it. But we know a man that is on his trail and a man that wants him in the worst way to get the people's belt back, and that's a junkyard dog. George Weingroff, a courageous man, but thus far, it's been all the offense has been with Hacksaw Butch Reed. Right there, Weingroff shows you his heart and his courage as he kicks out of a pinning predicament. Weingroff reverses it and sends Reed into the turnbuckle. Weingroff on top. Weingroff flips him right out of the corner. And now George Weingroff going to the offense. Weingroff going to the offense, that side suplex. Weingroff the side suplex in a pinning predicament. And the tremendous strength of Butch Reed powering out of that body press. And those hammers, those big hammers coming down on Weingroff, they'll take the toll out of any man. And Reed's got him up. Reed has him up, pressing him, full body press above his head. The tremendous strength of Reed illustrated right there in that maneuver. Weingroff trying groggily to get back to his feet. Reed going to the ropes, and Reed with that flying shoulder block, headbutt, and he's got him down for the count. Another victory for the North American champion.
Hacksaw Butch Reed, who felt like the fans didn't back him the way they should. Other wrestlers misled him, became his own man, and next to North American heavyweight title, and gains a victory here. And we'll be back when action continues after these words.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit in the red corner at 290 pounds from Reno, Nevada. Jim Neidhart. Yeah! And in the blue corner at 250 pounds from Topeka, Kansas, Art Cruz.
Art Cruz in the blue jacket and the black tight versus Jim Neidhart, who is a human anvil. And Jim, I know you'll be able to tell him something about that.
Well, Neidhart, 290 pounds, a drop kick right from the drop, right from the start, Jim Neidhart. Reno, Nevada, 290 pounds, and those anvil-like hammers of his. And he's getting right after the vastly improved Art Cruz, who had to be on the defensive fighting for his life here from the outset. Neidhart, a graduate of UCLA, high school All-American, both football and track. And he's in there with Art Cruz, and Cruz is not going to back up from him. I can guarantee you that. Neidhart, professional football player of the Dallas Cowboys and the Oakland Raiders. And Neidhart is a tough, tough with that right hand right to the midsection. And Neidhart with a big roundhouse right hand and another one. Neidhart, a world-class shot putter, the number one shot putter in the world in his age group when he was 18 years of age. A man that holds a world record in the anvil throw. The anvil throw, and Art Cruz with that big forearm. Cruz with that forearm. Neidhart backdrops him right over the top. Neidhart tremendously strong. 575-pound bench press. He's got him up. What a maneuver. That reverse backbreaker. Neidhart has got him with that reverse maneuver. A very unorthodox maneuver. And right here, and it didn't take him too long, at 290, the victor, Jim Neidhart.
And we still have time left. We still have action coming up, so stay with us. We'll return right after this message.
This event is for one fall or remaining television time in the red corner at 255 pounds from New York City, Tom Stanton. And in the blue corner at 220 pounds from Denton, Texas, Jerry Caldwell.
Jerry Caldwell from Denton, Texas in the light blue tights against the newcomer who's making his first appearance here on Mid-South, Tom Stanton. Pee Wee Anderson will be the referee. And there's the lowering of his hand, calling for the bell, and Jim Ross.
Thanks very much, Boyd. And right there you see the man is back, a very dangerous position. The inexperience of Jerry Caldwell may be showing through there, because I know a lot of guys were taking advantage of a man having his back to him that long. Tom Stanton, a very rangy individual, stands 6'3", 6'4", New York City, trying to come in here to the greatest wrestling establishment in all the world to make a name for himself. Going against young man from Denton, Texas, Jerry Caldwell. And gosh, we've had some tremendous amount of action today. Boyd, I'm almost out of breath and all the tremendous excitement that matchmaker Grizzly Smith has done. Nice arm drag takedown by Jerry Caldwell. And you know, we've had several confrontations where we've had size and strength against quickness and speed. And thus far, the size and strength has parlayed into winning combinations for the most part. We'll see how it stacks up here. There's a very devious forearm, that elbow right to the face, fist right to the face by the big man, Tom Stanton, New York City. Stanton and Jerry Caldwell here on Mid-South Wrestling. Stanton catches him come off the ropes, that big foot right to the solar plexus. Caldwell goes down. Stanton with another right hand, well placed right to the jaw of Caldwell. The headbutt, another headbutt, and Tom Stanton with that knee lift really trying to make short work out of Jerry Caldwell here on Mid-South Wrestling. And we've had a tremendous amount of action. Of course, next week we want to invite all of you back. We appreciate you allowing us to be in your homes every week. Next week right here on Mid-South Wrestling, you'll be able to see two of the top girl wrestlers in the country. They'll be here with us next week. Stanton with a double chop coming, catching Caldwell off the ropes. And Stanton is not showing a tremendous amount of amateur wrestling expertise, but he shows some tremendous signs of some roughhouse tactics as that clubbing right hand to the back of Jerry Caldwell. And Caldwell has spent most of this evening on the mat at the hands at the onslaught of Tom Stanton. There's a body slam. Stanton going for the pin, pinning predicament. As Cowboy Bill Watts has alluded to many times, he didn't wrap the leg up. Consequently, Caldwell kicked out. Front face lock.
Jim, on the back of Tom Stanton's tights, if the fans can't read it as he passes, was Ultimate Dream. And of course, right now, his ultimate dream is to gain a victory in his first appearance, because there's no way you can have a victory string of a lot of wins unless you win the first match. This is his first appearance here on Mid-South, and he's carrying the attack now to young Jerry Caldwell in search of a victory which would lead him on to the ultimate dream of higher spots on future cards.
Jerry Caldwell coming right back. Caldwell showing some fight and showing some heart as he's coming back against Tom Stanton. And Stanton backs into that corner. Now that's a dangerous area for both parties. It's a battle of the minds, a battle of the wits. Caldwell wades right in and comes out. Stanton reverses it, and there goes Caldwell. Caldwell into the turnbuckle, and Stanton catch him off the ropes with that elbow right to the head. And Stanton has turned the momentum back to his side.
We just have 1 minute, 60 seconds time remaining on television, Jim. I want to remind the fans that next week, the girls wrestlers will be here. We've had many requests for them.
And Stanton's going for that fall, and he's got it.
We have a victory by the ultimate dream, Tom Stanton, over Jerry Caldwell as our time is running down. We want to thank you fans for being with us this week. And, of course, our great production crew, our producer and director, Oral Link, the engineer, John Stokely, and our outstanding cameraman in the form of John Godwin and Paul White. And you fans at home make it a tremendous team, along with our expert commentary this week from Tulsa, Oklahoma, Jim Ross, who we're always glad to have him when he's in the area. I'm your host, Boyd Pearson. It's been a lot of excitement. There's more coming this way on the same channel next week. So we invite you to join us. Until then, goodbye, everybody, from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. Hello, wrestling fans, and welcome to this week's edition of Mid-South Wrestling Television. I'm your host, Boyd Pearson. We have a lot of exciting action. Battle of the Hacksaws this week here on Mid-South Wrestling. Hacksaw Jim Duggan versus Hacksaw Butch Reed. Also, the inimitable Junkyard Dog takes on 383-pound one-man gang. So many of you have asked us and written, requesting the popular girl wrestlers. They are here this week, and they'll be in a mixed tag team match. So lots of exciting action. There's none better to tell you about it than our guest commentator, Cowboy Bill Watts. Bill?
Well, I think you've said it all. Of course, the 313-pound Nikolai Volkov from Moscow, one of the world's Strong as Men. Also, Jim the Anvil Neidhart. A lot of great action. My friend Rusty Barber, some of the kids in wheelchairs, and a full packed house here at the Irish McNeil Boys Club. Let's go right to the ring for a great main event with Reese Bowden introducing it.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 387 and a half pounds and managed by General Skandor Akbar, the One Man Gang.
This is a story of famous dog. When the dog that chases its tail will be busy. He's a clapping dog.
Coming to the ring now, the Junkyard Dog.
There it goes without introduction now. Ricky Pereira called for the bell. The One Man Gang waiting for the incoming Junkyard Dog in the battle zone, Bill.
Well, I'll tell you, Akbar has really got a lot of the guys frothing at a fever pitch. And sometimes a disadvantage. Look at the One Man Gang. It looks like he's going for a fast ball. He was going for the post right then. 386 pounds, and the gang is no stranger to the Junkyard Dog. The gang is a man who wrecked Dusty Rhodes in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Got Dick Murdoch. Got Big Ernie Ladd, one of the last matches of his career, and got to the Junkyard Dog. So he has been in the employ and the pay of Skandor Akbar for quite some time. And you know when the general puts out the money, he's liable to bring them in, and they're always big and tough. He's got Kamala, the Ugandan warrior. He's had the one-man gang on the East Coast, headlining bouts in Charlotte, Raleigh, Roanoke, Greensboro, in the tremendous area of hotbed of wrestling in that area. So Akbar's tentacles go everywhere. But listen to this crowd. There's only one for this whole crowd. You hear them chanting, JYD, JYD. And JYD is 293 pounds, and look at the difference in size between him and this monster. A tremendous main event. But like I say, it's the size of the heart in the dog and the fight in the dog. That's what makes the difference. And JYD didn't pump that iron just to get to where he looked good. He pumped that iron. We'd have that strength to be able to pull it back when he had to go. And Butch Reed, North American champion, if you're watching, you watch this JYD, because I can guarantee he's going to be coming after you. Of course, you've got Hacksaw Dugan later today right here on TV. Reverse chin lock. Oh, the crowd saying, who that? Who that?
I was just going to comment there, Bill, that Junkyard Dog is in tremendous physical condition regardless of what Hacksaw Butch Reed says, and heavy hangs the crown of a champion. You know that's
through the years. Yeah, you hear the whole crowd rocking. Who that? Who that going to beat that Junkyard Dog? Who that? They're with him. They chant with him. This guy is a true hero. He doesn't ask for respect. He just walks out and demands it. He earned it. And I'll tell you, he remembers right where he came from, how hard it was to get there. Tremendous family man, beautiful daughter, lovely wife. And JYD is really proud of him and the things that the backing of all the fans have been able to provide for his family with his courage in that ring. Former football great, collegiate, played for the Green Bay Packers. He learned his trade. He traveled to Germany, to Calgary, wrestled some tough ones. Atomic Dog, they call him. Atomic Dog. Won the hearts of everyone. The colonel in Louisiana, honorary colonel, getting the keys to the city in New Orleans. Spends a lot of time helping children. Went to visit a youngster at the Burn Center. There he's showing the One Man Gang. He's introducing him to that steel turnbuckle. And the One Man Gang, this has been festering for a long time. Akbar didn't have to beg the dog into this match. He wanted it. He doesn't shy from competition. He runs toward it dead full speed. We see Nikolai Volkov standing off. I don't know if they catch a camera shot of him, the big Russian. He's certainly studying the Junkyard Dog very carefully. Anybody knows the background of the Russian athletes that have come up through their amateur ranks, they know why they dominate the Olympics. These guys study every move you make. They're watching their intent. There's this big 313-pound monster watching this bout between the Junkyard Dog and the One Man Gang. Nikolai Volkov was a strongest one-arm deadlift in the world at age 17. A powerful man. Did a one-hand deadlift of 600 pounds. Listen to that crowd chanting. Skandar Akbar really gloating right now. Crowd chanting for the champion, JYD, the people's champion, the king of Houston wrestling. Body slam. One man gang, good golly. Good golly. If he wipes, he will wipe dog out. Fortunately, with his ponderous bulk, it took him a little too long to get up there, and dog was able to get out of the way. But that's an awesome threat. Look, referee breaking him up. Now look at Akbar. Akbar, the scavenger, the jackal, the hyena, getting his shots in. The junkyard dog, he slapped the general's face. He really slapped the general's face, knocked his turban or his headgear or his tablecloth or whatever you call it clear off. Akbar wanted the one-man gang to fire JYD into him. He was going to punish him, but the dog beat him with a shot. Look at the howl. He's howling, and that's not the moon. He got him up for the thump. He thumped the big one-man gang. Look at Akbar. Rick Ferrar calling for the disqualification, but dog's got a piece of Akbar. He's going to gnaw on that bone for a while. Here comes Boris Zhirkov into the ring. Three of them on there. Nikolai Volkov strangely just standing there watching it all. Akbar waving. He's waving somebody in. Oh, it's Darso. He's waving Crusher Darso in, the man the Junkyard Dog beat this last week. And he's got dog at his mercy. There goes Darso. Darso hit the one-man gang. Darso hit the one-man gang. Something's gone wrong in the general's plans. Something's gone wrong in the general's plan, and Darso is beating the one-man gang up. Now Darso's beating up Zhirkov. Something's gone crazy. The general had waved Darso in. And now they're both beating up on Skandar Akbar and the one-man gang. They're on the run. Junkyard Dog, the winner by disqualification. And Darso going to leave the ring. Listen to this crowd here at the Irishman Neal Boys Club. JYD and Darso look at each other man to man. They met in a great battle here last week. Dog's looking at him. Darso looking back. These are two big men. I don't know if Darso's going to challenge him or what. Dog turned him around. Dog offered him his hand.
I'll tell you, Bill Watts, that's something else. I never expected to see anything like that when he came through the ropes after being urged in by Skandar Akbar. We'll be back. There's more action coming after this important message.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 260 pounds from Russia, Boris Zhirkov. And in the blue corner at 238 pounds from Indianapolis, Indiana, George Weingroff.
The flag waving Russian from the Kremlin, Boris Zhirkov, rolling up his flag, getting ready for the attack of popular George Weingroff, who outstanding amateur wrestler from the University of Tennessee, and now an outstanding professional grappler with a lot of courage, Bill.
That's right, and handicapped though he was waving that shirt of his that had USA on it against Zhirkov, because there's no love between Americans and Russians, especially with Russia again showing its true colors in the recent international events. Fireman's carry by Weingroff, and I see Nikolai Volkov stoically standing there, the powerful man watching this bout. And of course, Russia, you know, it amazes me when politicians and people think that you can bargain with Russia, that you can appease them. It's just like trying to appease the hand of a rattlesnake. They're going to strike and do as they please. The problem is we've let them get so strong, they can do as they please and laugh at us now. And certainly the American athletes really resent this. I hope the American people do too. You look at all the countries that have had signed agreements with Russia. Estonia, my wife is Estonia. She can tell you a lot about what the treaties with Russia mean. It means they walk in and take over your country when you're unarmed, ship your leaders off to Siberia and to death camps that they never return from.
I shouldn't get that outspoken here on television, but I got to lay it down like it is. I believe in America, but I believe in a strong America. And I'm for George Weingroff or anybody that's against Zhirkov or Volkov or Gromykov or any of the other ones. Andropov. Good move by George Weingroff. If George Weingroff wrestled everybody with the intensity that he's wrestled this man, I'll guarantee you he'd beat a lot of them. I think George is just such a great athlete, and being a handicapped individual, I think he starts out from a position of giving them too much of an advantage. But he has sure been an aggressive man here tonight, I'll guarantee you. But of course, Zhirkov is a tremendous athlete too. There he goes for that reverse neckbreaker. He's got George. He's got George for the reverse neckbreaker. Now he goes up for the coup de grace, just like Russia grinds everybody under their boot. They've changed the world map as you see countries fall to them. Like Lennon said, America will sell us enough rope to hang them, hang themselves. And of course, he didn't add that we'd have it on credit. But Weingroff's got him. Weingroff's got him in an abdominal stretch and falls back. Weingroff. Weingroff got the victory. USA all the way. USA.
Look at the fans and look at George Weingroff. He's so excited, Bill.
Volkov coming in the ring. Volkov coming in the ring. Volkov and some kind of argument with Zhirkov. And Zhirkov, Russian attacking Russian. Volkov's annihilating Zhirkov. I don't know what they are saying to each other. There was some kind of heated words exchanged. And the powerful Volkov is beating up one of his own countrymen. I'd love to see another civil war in Russia, not only just in this wrestling ring. Look at the power of Volkov. He takes that 270-pounder down, back breaks him, then picks him up, presses him, and down again. I've never seen such power. This is a powerful machine. And Zhirkov leaves helpless on the floor, laying there, and now look at Volkov stare at everybody.
And we'll be back when action continues after this message on Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
We just saw a very unusual situation, Boyd, and we had Jim Ross standing by. We were going to try to get him to interview Barry Darso during one of the commercial breaks to see just what happened in that junkyard dog situation. But he's gone into the ring, and we've asked him to go into the ring and interview Nikolai Volkov and see just what caused this problem between the two Russians. Let's go to the ring and Jim Ross right now.
In all of professional wrestling, there are only three or four Russian wrestlers in the United States. The wrestling fans, I'm sure the wrestling fans from coast to coast are wondering exactly what happened, what transpired in your mind to turn on a fellow countryman, a man from your homeland, a man from Russia.
He is not from Russia. He's born here in the United States. He's not born like me for the motherland. When they grow men, he's born here in the United States. When a professional lad is blown like a little puppy, beer belly, puppy with a belly button, who have no guts to fight? I'm sick and tired of those guys that sit here in Russia. He's not Russia. He's from here. If he's from Russia, he never lost the match because Russian athletes never lost the match. If you look at the Olympics, Russian athletes get more gold medals on every Olympics than all other athletes from all other countries in the whole world. You're telling me I am from Russia? I have my mind from Russia. When I fight here, I don't fight for myself. I fight for my motherland from Russia. Let me tell you, when the Russian talking, when the Russian talking, people listen. Otherwise, if you don't listen, you'll get what you deserve. Because we are back up from nobody. We are the strongest country in the whole world. The strongest athletes, military the strongest. We are back up from nobody. We are athletes, we come here to fight. I come here to fight, and I see guys like this make me sick, turn my stomach out. Hey, tell me why I did, you know why? Because I believe it is better to be boss in the hell than be torture in the heaven.
Those comments from Nikolai Volkov. And now let's go back to Cowboy Bill Watts.
Well, I couldn't understand it all, but he was pretty upset. He's saying that Zhirkov was born in the United States and not a true Russian, that he is from the motherland. And when he fights or wrestles, he fights for the motherland. And that you certainly saw the hardcore line. And I believe you saw a real insight of just what he thinks of the United States. And I don't think any of us can be under any illusion as what the populace of Russia thinks about the United States. Let's go to Reeser Bowden now, the next bout in the ring.
And it's tag team action now for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 420 pounds from Atlantic City, New Jersey, King Kong Bundy. And his partner at 251 pounds from parts unknown, Max, the missing link. In the blue corner at 220 pounds from Denton, Texas, Jerry Caldwell. And his partner at 232 pounds from Lakewood, Ohio, Denny Alberts.
Tag team action being introduced. There's Denny Alberts in the maroon clad and his partner leaving the ring now, Jerry Caldwell, against both men dressed in black in the ring, the missing link, Max, named by General Skander Akbar, and on the outside, his partner, King Kong Bundy.
Well, I'll tell you, if his name's Max, he doesn't have any other name, you got it from me. It's Mad Max, because he's not playing with a full deck. But Denny Alberts out there showing some of the quickness. The problem when you've got that jackrabbit speed, you oftentimes don't have that long-term endurance. And when you're up against a guy like Mad Max, a man that you can see is trained like a machine in the gym, a powerhouse with that tremendous physique and that racehorse body, you better go to the post in all four quarters. We're still going to have Jim Ross try to get Barry Darso, or Crusher Darso, and ask him just what transpired, because apparently Skander Akbar had him standing by as an insurance policy with the one-man gangs action, and Darso somehow upset Akbar's apple cart, and we'd just like to get to the bottom of it.
386-pound King Kong Bundy now, Devastation Incorporated, in the ring against Jerry Caldwell.
Well, I think a lot of the fast action will come to a quick halt because those guys can do all the jumping and moving they want. And Bundy can stand there like a big, huge skyscraper and just wait, because sooner or later, they got to come in to beat him. And when you come into King Kong Bundy, you're coming into his strength. If you get Bundy to moving and chasing you, you take away his power, because a big man like him is not going to have the tremendous agility for a lot of directional changes. But he can stand out there like a rock at Gibraltar, and there's no warnings or no stalling in professional wrestling because there's not a time limiting factor except here on television where there's one fall or 10 minute time limit. This creates some problems where guys like Bundy are at a strategy disadvantage. Of course, he's got a quick partner in there, the missing link, who's a devastating athlete. We saw what he did to the Junkyard Dog 2 weeks ago. And then last week, right here to Magnum TA, where they almost didn't even care. They just want a missing link that seems to want to punish people or to hurt them. And look, you show that wrestling ability and that he certainly knows his leverage, as there's another fall taken by the missing link in King Kong Bundy.
And we have more action coming up. Stay with us. We'll be right back after this word.
Well, Boyd, we got Jim the Anvil Neidhart coming up next, a former All-American in high school in football and track, a former UCLA shot putter, All-American football player, played with the Dallas Cowboys, the Oakland Raiders, and also is the world's champion anvil thrower. For those of you that don't know what an anvil is, that's a blacksmithing tool, a huge, heavy piece of metal they use to work on horseshoes or bending other metal. And he won this world's record toss at the Calgary Stampede in Canada. He'll be up next. But first, Jim Ross caught Crusher Darso in the upfront interview, ringside, and during the commercial break, and I'm sure we're all wondering what happened. Let's hear it in the Crusher's own words, and I think it'll be an enlightenment to us all.
Last week right here on Mid-South Wrestling, all the wrestling fans saw your undefeated win streak come to a halt at the hands of the Junkyard Dog in a very hard-fought match, a match that could have gone either way. The Junkyard Dog was the victor, however. And then today, here on Mid-South Wrestling, it looked like General Skander Akbar had a well-laid plan, like he had recruited you to come to the aid of his men in case he needed the help. Well, he needed the help, and you came to the ring, but you helped the Junkyard Dog. I'm sure the whole wrestling world was shocked. Now, I was shocked, and like many of our fans, would like to know exactly what happened, what was going through your mind.
Well, here's the situation. General Akbar did offer me a large sum of money. He offered me $500, and I have it right here. And I was just thinking about it all week here, after Junkyard Dog. He defeated me fair and square, and it's the first time I've ever taken a whooping like that. I mean, the guy just beat me fair and square. And from where I come from, up in the North Woods of Minnesota, I was taught to do things right, fair and square, one-on-one, and I had my pride here. I was taught to work hard and things will come to you. And when General Akbar offered me this money, I was sick and tired of having two, three guys in on Junkyard Dog. I've been watching him for weeks, ever since I came into Mid-South here. And it just seems like he hasn't had a fair shake, and I just figured that was it. And I'd really appreciate it if you could give General Akbar his money. I don't need any of this Arab gold anymore. It's just, money's not worth it to me.
Well, there you hear from a very proud young man, a great young athlete, Crusher Darceau, and that's all we have from ringside at this time.
Well spoken by a powerful young man, but boy, don't anybody be lulled asleep. You know, in the North Woods up there, and those guys in Minnesota, when they say fair and square, one-on-one, that means one-on-one with axe handles, boots, knucks, whatever.
Whatever's available.
He's ready to fight. He's just saying he believes it should be one-on-one. And now let's go to the ring where Reese Bowden is going to introduce the next bout.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, at 290 pounds from Reno, Nevada, Jim the Hammer Neidhart. And in the blue corner at 232 pounds from Fort Worth, Texas, Ron Ellis.
Ron Ellis versus the man, Bill, because of his record and because of his qualifications that you talked about earlier, it's Jim the Anvil Neidhart.
That's right, the Anvil's after him. And I can say the Anvil, he won that throw in Calgary at the big Stampede celebration. That's a 100-pound Anvil. He threw it 22 feet to win the world championship. This man was ranked fifth in the world in the shot put in 1975, and he was a national shot put champion in 1973. Played for the Dallas Cowboys, played nose tackle for the Oakland Raiders. So he's a rugged guy, 575-pound bench press, and he's just a machine. And Ron Ellis is feeling his ire. He was out there hollering at Ron Ellis before Reese Bowden even made the introduction. Powerful man, broad shouldered. He's got to be quick. If you play nose tackle defense, you got to have that tremendous quickness as well as that strength, because you get hit from all sides. That gives you some indication of just what kind of tough guy this guy is. Yeah, an interesting battle between him and Hacksaw Dugan, wasn't it? Because Dugan was kind of known as a nut in the National Football League, and he speared a few people, and he was on those suicide squads. So you put these two crazies together, and you might see some skin fly. Thinking about Jim Hacksaw Dugan, he's up next against Hacksaw Butch Reed in a battle of hacksaws right here on television. This was a match that Grizzly, oh, Neidhart's saying, get up to Ellis. And Ellis made a mistake, he got up. Oh, that fall away suit play out of a fireman's carry position. That's an awesome move. Reminds me of the Samoans.
Awesome, and with that power that Jim Neidhart used, it was advantageous to a victory over Ron Ellis. We'll be back. The Battle of the Hacksaws after this word from Mid-South.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit in the red corner. 260 pounds from Kansas City, Missouri, the North American heavyweight champion, Hacksaw Butch Reed. And across the ring at 282 pounds from New York City, Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
It's more than a battle of New York versus Kansas City, more than a battle of the Hacksaws. It's Jim Duggan versus Butch Reed, Bill.
This match was a surprise bout. Grizzly Smith had not even announced it, and the people were standing on their feet when they saw these men come out. A 260-pound brick house on your left against a 282-pound crazy man, a man that has no regard for his own personal safety. Jim Hacksaw Dugan, a battle of the Hacksaws. And there's been some battles, and of course, it's been just stuck in Dugan's craw ever since Hacksaw Butch Reed showed on TV where he beat Hacksaw Dugan in New Orleans in a battle of the Hacksaws. Magnum T.A. has just come out. Magnum T.A. is coming out. George Weingroff, there's the people coming around. I don't know if they're coming around to spectate or coming around to maybe make sure it stays and Crusher Darceau's words one-on-one, because the last time these two men met right here on Mid-South Wrestling, if Dugan won the match, he's supposed to get 5 minutes alone with Skandar Akbar. Akbar had the mighty Kamala hidden in the wings. And of course, right here today, we know he has the one-man gang. Johnny Rich just came out. So while there's a real battle going on in the ring, there's getting to be some support. The wrestlers themselves are coming out just as a kind of camaraderie
that they want the big Hacksaw Dugan to have a one-on-one shake. And I'm sure Dugan's the kind of man says, if Reed can beat me fair and square one-on-one, I'll say he's a better man. The Junkyard Dog has just strolled out, the Big Thumper himself. There's quite a bond between these two guys. Quite a rough and tumble bond. And Butch Reed out on the floor. Hey, they're throwing him back in the ring. We got a lumberjack match. An unsigned, unofficial lumberjack match, Boyd Pierce.
Exactly, and that's Crusher Darso is down to the ring
Crusher
now.
Crusher Darso's out there. A lot happening. Only on Mid-South Wrestling. You know, it really warms my heart to read the mail that comes into Mid-South Wrestling. Oh, a dog. Dog is the first one in to throw Butch Reed right back in the ring. He calls him fried, died, and laid to the side. But it warms my heart to get the mail from the fans out there watching Mid-South Wrestling, that watch wrestling from all over the country now with the cable systems and the tremendous amount of wrestling around the country on television. And they always say how great Mid-South. Oh, Dog and Reed are hooking it up. And Dog gets leveled.
Brother, did he lay
Dog
one on
just
him?
Just laid one on Butch Reed. Notice Dugan. Dugan's not jumping. He's not jumping to the advantage. Dugan wants a victory on his own, and he realized that he's tasted dog's soup bones before. He realized that Reed's a little bit scattered right now. He gave Reed a chance to clear his head, but the Hacksaw wants that victory, and he's right back on the attack. But Reed didn't get to be North American champion by watching these press clippings. He's been in that gym training. He's hungry. He came up hard, and he says it's the biggest opportunity of his life, and he's going to whip them all. And he's in shape, and he says he'll take any athlete that gets in there with him right to the limit and then push him past it and beat him. So this is a real battle between these two giants. Personal scores to settle, and there's all these guys out there to make sure the crowd's standing. They're chanting, Dugan, Dugan, Dugan.
They're making sure it's a one-on-one confrontation, Bill.
And we still got girls' match to come, a mixed tag. A girl and a man on each side against another girl and a man. So we got a ton of action. This has got to be one of the all-time great Mid-South wrestling events that Grizzly Smith has ever had here. I'm telling you, it's just a pleasure, Boyd, to be here with you. And for you folks to invite us in your home to see these great bouts. Look at the crowd. They're chanting. They're standing. Dugan, Dugan, Dugan. They're wanting Dugan to come, but he's against a man that's a mean machine. I mean, a 260-pound brick house, in his own words. Harry caught him with that quick forearm. There's two guys that played in the NFL, too. Reed played with the Kansas City Chiefs. These guys are athletes. I mean, these guys have been to, they've been to the right up on, scratched on that line before. They know what it's all about to get down, get sweaty. They know what it's like to train. No gain without pain. They understand it. They pay the price. Oh, look at that. Gorilla Slam. He's got Dugan up. 282 pounds he just put up in that Gorilla Slam. When I'm talking about a brick house, you got to give the devil credit even. But Dugan powered out. Dugan's got a fighting heart. Dugan doesn't know die. He doesn't know quit. He doesn't know give. Reed's taking it to him. This is a battle of two that won't give up. Two men that will. Oh, he went for the slingshot at Dugan. Dugan cleared under it. Dugan cleared under it. Reed missed the big slingshot. There's the spear. There's the spear. Dugan's got him. Dugan's got him. Dugan's got him. Look at this crowd, Boyd. Look at him standing. Look at the guys congratulating. Look at everybody congratulating Hacksaw Dugan. And there's still more to come.
A tremendous victory for Hacksaw Dugan. He put it all into it and let him have it full force. We'll be back when action continues after this important message.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 255 pounds from New York City, Tom Stanton. And in the blue corner at 238 pounds from Virginia Beach, Virginia, Magnum T.A.
From New York City, Tom Stanton, the man with the Ultimate Dream versus the popular grappler from Virginia Beach, Virginia, Magnum T.A.
That should be a great bout. Big Tom Stanton came rolling in here last week with a great victory. And Magnum T.A., a youngster that's come out of the tutelage of the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, and come right up here, and he's one half of the Mid-South Tag Championship with Hacksaw Jim Duggan. He's been running in some tall company. He's been up against some bruisers. He's had to go against King Kong Bundy, against the Missing Link, against Kamala, against Booker. This kid has cut his teeth on being tough. He's quick, and he's learns. He's after it. He wants it. He's hungry. He's taken a few bad weapons, but he's beat some people. He's upset some people, and he's walked tall on speed. He'll hit you a belly-to-belly suplex at any time out there. He's got some great background. Boy, boy, this has been a dynamite, action-packed hour, and we still got Debbie Combs and Johnny Rich to go against Donna Day and Art Cruz in a mixed tag match. And I may quickly tell you, the mixed tag, it's supposed to be girl against girl and man against man. And if the girl tags her partner, the man in, then the other one is supposed to tag out and put the man in. There's never supposed to be man against woman in this bout. It's called a mixed tag team match. Should be a lot of excitement. Quick arm drag, Japanese arm drag underneath. Magnum up in an arm bar.
Bill Magnum T.A. was one of the grapplers who came to the ring in that battle between Hacksaw Duggan and Hacksaw Butch Reed to form an unscheduled lumberjack style to make sure it was one-on-one.
Oh, Reed was really griping during the commercial break, and the fans were standing and chanting. They loved Hacksaw Duggan's great victory here. And, of course, he can thank his friends for backing him up all the way to make sure he got a fair shot, because I'm sure there were some people looking for an opportunity to come in and take advantage, because Akbar is always sniffing around. Oh, good move, crossbody block. Almost got him. And T.A. is always trying to hang in there to help out Duggan. Oh, you're telegraphing way too far, T.A. You want to cut the distance down between you and your opponent when you make broad, fast moves like that. But there he goes. He didn't telegraph that. He just stepped in, kicked the hips in, and hit it.
And it resulted in a victory over Tom Stanton for Magnum T.A. Remember, the mixed tag team match coming up, girl and man on each team, and we'll be watching it with you right after this important word.
And now a mixed tag team action. This event is for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner at a dainty 135 pounds from St. Louis, Missouri, Donna Day. And her partner at 250 pounds from Topeka, Kansas, Art Cruz. In the blue corner at 138 pounds from Nashville, Tennessee, Debbie Combs. And her partner at 238 pounds from Hendersonville, Tennessee, Johnny Rich.
Mixed tag team action being introduced now as Donna Day from Missouri and her next state neighbor, Art Cruz, as her partner against the two stars from Tennessee, Debbie Combs and Johnny Rich.
Oh, and they don't waste any time, Boyd Pierce. I know Debbie Combs, her mother Cora Combs, would be a great lady wrestler. You know, it seems to me almost a shame, Sergeant, these ladies must work to get their hair so nice to appear on TV, that you know this is one sport that's just not too kind on it.
Long hair can really be used to a disadvantage in professional wrestling, Bill, as I'm sure we'll see the match progresses.
Before the evening's over, but here's two guys that are no stranger to those young up-and-comers. We've watched them really improve here. You know, last week, I guess Johnny Rich was manhandled the worst I've ever seen him in his career by that Nikolai Volkov. Well, Volkov just was too much. I've seen Johnny Rich go get some tough guys and give good credit of himself and beat a bunch of them, but Volkov just annihilated him. But Johnny Rich and Art Cruz are evenly matched. Art Cruz, we've watched really improve here on Mid-South. He's become tremendously aggressive. And Johnny's a little upset about that. Art took him right over, and Donna Day slapped him. I'm sure there's a lot of ladies in the audience that like to do a lot of things to Johnny Rich, but probably slapping him is not one of them. That old blue eyes, those eyes were sparking a little fire.
Johnny
there.
Wanted to wait now as Donna Day came in the ring, but he's being forced to leave.
Donna Day is kind of taking it by the rules of this tag match. As I said before, it's supposed to be when the man tags out and the woman tags in that his opponent tags out and gets the other lady in there. It's supposed to be lady against lady and man against man. Good leg trip takedown by Debbie Combs. Up into a full Nelson. Oh, Johnny wants it. Johnny, oh, the crowd. Johnny, no, Johnny. Oh, he,
whoa.
Johnny, look at Johnny Rich. He kissed her.
He put it on her. Oh. Look at her.
Johnny Rich really turned the tables. I was sure hoping. Oh, Johnny just kicked Art Cruz right over the top. Debbie Cove, I was sure hoping Johnny wouldn't slap her. That would have really taken him down a little notch in my respect for him, but he really turned the tables on her. He surprised her. Oh, Art Cruz went for her. He went after Debbie Combs, and Art Cruz is getting a little bit rambunctious, and Johnny made him pay a little price there. The referee should be a little bit quicker over there on Art Cruz, getting him out of that ring. Thank goodness that Debbie Combs was quick enough to get out of the way. These girls have to be quick out there. A great event. This is one of the greatest television events. Boyd, I've really enjoyed being here with you again. Jim Ross caught a couple of key interviews there. A lot of things happening. Grizzly Smith has done another great one. It's all looking up. The next Superdome event, I might mention, is Saturday, November the 19th. We've always been on Thanksgiving in Superdome, but LSU and Tulane are going to play a collegiate football game, and we agreed to let them have that Thanksgiving, so Channel 17, Ted Turner would broadcast that, so wrestling has helped make it possible, a great event for the fans there in New Orleans, and we'll be the Saturday prior to Thanksgiving, November the 19th. About a minute and a half of airtime left here.
Boy, it's action time in the ring, I'll
tell
you that.
All four of them out there now. They're out there trucking on it. Johnny Rich and Art Cruz have flat gotten it on with each other. That's just pure competition. And Art Cruz just got bounced out.
Debbie Combs with the upper hand now on Donna Day.
I can't see from this side of the, but apparently Donna Day just submitted out there. A great victory for Johnny Rich and Debbie Combs. And the fans are giving a standing ovation as they've had a great, great bounce here this evening, Boyd.
A lot of bouts. The fans have been asking for the girls. They've been asking for a mixed team match. We got it all this week, and I know that everybody's happy as our time run out. Next week, Leaping Lanapapo will be here now.
He's a great athlete. He can jump. He can fly. He is acrobatic. He has gymnastic style. A great athlete from the Papo family, and he'll make his debut here.
And we'll be looking forward to it, and we hope you'll join us next week. And thank you so much for watching for Cowboy Bill Watts with another great job as our expert guest commentator. I'm Boyd Pierce saying goodbye, everybody, until next week on this same channel on Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.